please bear with us. We'll be live shortly. Do what to share. And the topic we're discussing tonight is right under the chat box. Do what to share. Let's get this running. We'll be live. We'll be with you shortly. We'll be with you shortly. We're discussing the topic you're seeing right there in the comment section. Do we have what it takes to change in African narratives? Case study Nigeria. Do we really have what it takes to change the narrative in the African environment? Join us on this conversation tonight. Please do well to share. Okay, I think we are ready to go live now. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. We're here now and the show is about to start. You know how we roll, you know how we do it. Tonight, quickly, the topic is, do we have what it takes to change the African narrative? Case study Nigeria, do we really have what it takes to change the African narratives? This is the question before us. Now, may we reason out properly. You know how with the role, yeah, with the flow, the way, with the yarn, yeah? It don't matter how it come, even if it means you speaking your native dialect, you are welcome. Now, but be sure that on day to day, you look at what is actually going on in the environment, you look at what is actually happening in our vicinity. If you look at Africa environment, and they talk as one to say, the issue where we get across the country, they're the same, they are like Okereka button. And what I mean by Okereka button, if you look more than the problem when they happen for Nigeria to a different African country, you see that they are alike. And I believe that a solution template that will work in one country will likely work in other countries, in other African countries, with a little or no tweak. Now, but the question we never ask ourselves is, do we really have what it takes? We get what it will take us to actually build that African society that we crave for. Do we really have what it takes to put Africa on the track for success? Because currently, we don't see different moves to actually change the system. We don't see different young people come up with different movements, with different activism and stuff like that, with different intention to change the system. But all till date, none of them have actually been able to successfully put forward that template that can actually drive Africa to the right track. And this evening, I'm here with my brother. I'm here with my very good brother. Let me bring him up quickly before we start this conversation. Now, we don't see a lot of people coming up with this idea, say, we won't change Nigeria, we won't change Africa. But we never really see any solution concretely when it actually put people on track or put any of the country on track. Is it an error or whenever they apply the right strategy? This is the conversation we have, and that is the conversation that's before you as an African youth, as a Nigerian. It doesn't matter where you're watching us from. Drop your views in the comment section and let's get this conversation running again. Let me bring my friend and brother in. Mr. Rewan, you're welcome.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you. Now, the question, I'll pop it on you, you open the floor, so I will get the conversation rolling, yeah? If I was just thinking about it this afternoon, I was like, now the Canada come up. Its initial intention was to actually build a better Nigeria. But when things not a work, he don't try, not a work. He not came up with his Biafra agenda that I think the best thing to do, maybe we cut out our own. If they don't want, maybe we give us space to change the system, then we might as well be given the opportunity to cut out, maybe we build our own nation, as it were. Yeah? Then, yeah. We don't see Show when he come up with his own agenda too. He don't try expose corruption, it not work. Then, last, he goes, okay, make a court contest. Possibly Agofi changes win election and change the system, but currently we can see what is going through. This is just a few of many other people. When does see the race movement and race, we don't see Bobby Wine for Uganda. You get currently you see what's going to go through and what is going on in the country as well. The question before us is, do you think we have what it takes to build a better Africa? Do you think we have what it takes? Make a level for you, you open the floor.
I will not say yes, and I'm not going to say no. But if I say yes, I think I have to expand further of what I mean by yes. Mm-hmm. And on the other hand, if I say no, I think I also, hold a duty to explain the reason why I say no. But of course, I stand to be corrected, and I also want our viewers to listen attentively. This is not a matter of sentiment. It is a matter of what ought to be and what is. You see, the African continent, let me put it that way, or the Nigerian system, you see, like I tell people, for every policy you see on paper, they're as good as that, you want things to change or to turn around, or you want to change the narrative. But the question is the foundation in which we want to actually make all of these things, out of the day. Are they solid? That is the fundamental question. You see, one thing that I thought of when I, saw the topic of discussion today, I was actually ruminating on the concept of basic knowledge and basic education. I think when we look at that two concepts, that is the concept of basic knowledge and basic education, realize that the jet towards the same understanding. But then for me, if I have to conceptualize basic knowledge and basic education, on that of basic knowledge can mean just the normal understanding by anybody, whether educated or not educated. And when we talk about basic education is the means of educating somebody to understand the civic, education of the kind of society that he or she lives in. You see, it is a sorry state in that continent that we tend to be very selfish. Of course, human by nature, they say selfish, because of our rational and irrational decisions. But then if you look at some of these developed world, you know, of course they have their own challenges. But then you realize that, you know, the basic knowledge about organized society is what is helping them. And that's why they've continued. But the question is, in Africa, don't we have, you know, such kind of knowledge? And what do we say is the problem? Is it that we don't, you know, imbibe the right policy like you asked? You know, the question is, it's not as if we don't have the right policy. And of course, on the other hand, it's not as if we don't have the right people to really, you know, implement this policy to change the narrative. But then the culture in this context now is not, you know, the way of our dressing, is not the way of, you know, the food we eat, it's not of our differences. The culture in this context is just that, you know, character, the attitude of life. People, is it synonymous to that bring development? Is our culture, you know, we used to have in those days, the culture of togetherness, you know, that, you know, in those days, I can easily go to Mr. B's house to, okay, when they bring out food, we eat and share together. But today, the question is, if I go to Mr. B's house, the next question I'll ask myself is, if I eat there, hope I won't be poisoned. I hope, or maybe at the end of the day, tomorrow, the person will not say, oh, this person came to my house and was begging for food. So now, the point is, the issue of understanding why we are and why the narrative has refused to change is the fact that our culture has remained so static in a way and manner that, you know, it is what the scientists call antagonistic contradiction. That's you know, in some cases you have the like pose and the opposite and the negative. But now in our own case, we have the positive, you know, coming together. And it's just like you take a red wire that has light in it, and you take another red wire that has light in it. If you bring both together, what do you think will happen? You know, definitely it's going to be shock. Which can lead to anything. So that is what I feel, you know, is the situation that we have now, whereby, you know, we have failed to agree with one another. You know, it's just like the game of football. They say football is football is a universal language where everybody, regardless of where you come from, regardless of who you are, when you get to the field of play, you have to speak the same language. When you get in the living together as a people, are we actually, even though we don't speak the same language, do we actually do things in a way and manner that will demand respect? An average African man does not respect his fellow African. An average, you know, person, you know, in Africa does not even believe that is what we call respect for self-esteem. Talk less of somebody's human rights. So the point is, if we actually wanted to change the narrative, it's not easy. Policies might be, you know, very good, very brilliant on papers. You know, we have had as much as, you know, too many white papers. You mentioned that. The Shure and the likes. See, the question I ask is, in law, that is what we call, he who comes to equity must come with clean hands. You know, and that has been the base of our problem. When you see somebody championing a cause, the question you ask that person, is this cause that you are championing? Is it a true state of what you actually wanted us? Some kind, you know, telling you to go do this. Of course, we have seen so many, you know, sponsored attacks, you know, sponsored protests, sponsored agitation, sponsored political movement, not everything. You know, it's just like somebody, I will not mention him, which we know very well in that part of the country, who cannot even run a particular small business organization successfully. And now he's moving around saying, oh, he wants to contest for governorship in 2023. He wants to change the narrative. He's been spending money around somebody who cannot manage it in a small business to make money for himself. And the question you should ask yourself is, where is he getting this money that he's spending to, you know, do all these things? And he's telling us he wants to change the narrative. At the end of the day, if he gets there, what do you think will happen? So the point is, if you see people, you know, coming up to say, oh, I'm coming to change the narrative, you need to check them. You know, checking them as a result of the fact that, is this thing, you know, actually coming from your mind? Are you really interested in the plight of the people? Or somebody somewhere is actually engineering you to say, okay, go ahead, will support you. Right. At the end of the day, those who engineered you to go ahead will still become the same godfather that we are trying to fight in the country. So let's not deceive ourselves. So the question of having good policy, you know, not having the you know, to implement those good policy or to imbibe those good policy as a working, you know, way of life will actually, you know, continue to become a problem for us if care is not taken. So I think I don't know if I've, you know, tried to like
thank you very much. Yeah, you've actually thrown light on some key areas, yeah. And that is like the area of respect, the area of self-esteem, value, you get. Now, me will look at more that area. Now, one area when we say, if you attend most of these Pan-African meetings, they actually deliberate on this kind of thing, that if you look at the African problem, that it is unique. You get?
Yeah.
That the impact of slavery is still running through the current behavior and the trend we see in the continent. But I always say something, that for how long do we really say the impact of slavery run in our descent? And if it is, what should be the approach? What strategy would take to actually put an end to this one? We say every time we say slavery, because we can't continue to live like this. That's one thing we must all agree on. That even though we say okay, now impact of slavery or not, we will still agree on something to say there must be a way out. There is a way that we can actually liberate ourselves as a people, as a continent, you know what I mean? There's something we can put in place. There's a strategy we can approach. Okay, these are the people, this is their problem, or this is the situation of things at the moment. What can we do? You get the point now? Now,
yeah, as much as I understand what you are trying to, you know, say, I would say that before colonialism came,
mm-hmm.
post slavery and, you know, whatever thing that we call it, before they came, we had our cultures,
mm-hmm.
and cultures, you know, are still living with us.
Mm-hmm.
Some are trying to finish it, or some are still trying to keep and, you know, value it. They still, you know, still very, very much with us. Now, when colonialism came, if you recall very well, when they created the Southern, the Northern Protectorate, and the Lagos Colony, you know, at that time we had like three. Even not in that context, if you study colonial structures, you know, in part of Africa, you recall that in some countries, you know, the colonial masters, depending on the country colonizing, especially that of the French colonies, that the policy of association.
Mm-hmm.
In the English colony, we had the indirect rule. Now, the two different things I've mentioned here, when you talk of policy of association, you know, there are ways at which they implemented it. If you come to the idea of indirect rule, there are ways, you know, that all of these things were implemented. And of course, coming down to Nigeria, you know, in the northern Nigeria, we had what we call a proclamation. The indirect rule, you know, by the way of proclamation,
mm-hmm.
you know, in the north. In the south, I think they had a different, you know, agenda, and like in the east, that different agenda. Now, bringing all these things together, it still didn't take away our cultures. I'll give you an example. An average Yoruba man believes that if you want to, you know, greet somebody who is elderly, regardless of the numbers of years that the person is older than, you have to greet that person with respect. You know, by doing, you know, by prostrating or, you know, whichever means of showing respect. You understand what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
If you go to the Hausa land, if they have to greet their head as a Osiran Kadidi, you know, this is whether it is culture, whether it is the bend down. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
You know, in the part, I know there's also a means at which, you know, elders are being given regard. Of course, colonialism, slavery did not take all of these things away. Colonialism, slavery did not take our food away. Colonialism, slavery did not take our ancient belief. You know, if you go to some, you know, if you go to some areas today, they still have that belief that they are the people of whatever. You understand the point?
Mm-hmm.
This is our tradition, our culture. This is what we do. You know, if you go to the north, you know, some part of the North, like, are just, you know, like the TV people, the better people, they have their ways of doing things.
Mm-hmm.
If you come out west, if you go to Ife, you know, our cultures and traditions are still there. You go to Oshogbo, our cultures and traditions are still there. If you go to Oyo, the Oyo Empire, you know, who happens to be the, you know, the cultures are, you go to Ibadan, you go to everywhere, you know, you go to Ondo, the cultures are still there. You go to the East, I can't remember, not of in Anambra, they are still there. Is that the point I'm making?
Mm-hmm.
All of this colonialism didn't take them away. But the moment we fail to realize that we must, you know, go back, you know, by the way of life of our forefathers who value tradition so much, then we are going to get it wrong in whichever means that we have adopted today.
Mm-hmm.
Who like it or not, look at the country where we live in today. It's not in the MP or whatever, the council or whatever will do. It is the proclamation of the Queen, which happens to be their own culture.
Mm.
That happens to be the order of the day. So the point is, everybody has their own culture, regardless with our contacts, you know, with colonialism or whatever. But then if we have to, you know, do things the right way, I think going back, understanding and adding a deeper knowledge of our culture will, you know, go a long way to help us, rather than parabolating all around.
Yeah, but when you say culture, I think I've had this kind of conversation with someone before where I said that the only way to change the current crop of leaders that we have in Africa as a whole is to use our traditional gods as a means of oath. That way, a typical African person fear Ayelala, past Bible or Quran. So if they say, okay, if you want to take that, we have those in different regions. You know, if you come to the south, they have their own. If you go to the east, they have their major one that they are afraid of. I suggested, okay, no, that if you want to go by this one, will get the carry Bible to do oath. I swear by this, I swear by that. You use Quran and they just take oath. That we don't have respect for our religion, but we carry the religion more than anything else, as if we are actually being truthful to the religion. The question I was like, okay, what if they bend our leaders? Okay, if you to serve in any district for a period of time in Africa, if you're to serve, you swear by any of these gods. And we know that those gods, they don't hear tomorrow. If you go to your country, you know what I mean? That will limit the level of corruption. But having said that, do you think the African problem, my view, not be only bottom a day, not be only top a day, you get? And they talk about every time, say, okay, with the current corporate level, with the leaders, bad, bad, bad. Most of the Africans that are elderly, they are old people, they are weak. You get? They may have good intention, but truth is, the energy and the zeal will not be there to chase it, to meet current day demand. And that thing is, the current state of people, if they are corrupt, those who are corrupt among them, you cannot change them because it's something they've been used to from time immemorial. So it is difficult changing an elderly person of that regard. You get the point? So I'm saying, okay, why will not they focus efforts? That's why, to me, sometimes I feel like it's like we're chasing shadows. We're living the real thing, but we're chasing the wrong, the shadows of the real thing. Now, the real thing we want to, we were actually at, people, they say, okay, I didn't raise this movement. If the intention is genuine and clear, are we sincere? Yeah? I believe we'll be solution driven as against being just critic or just being just for the fun of being an activist. You get the point? Because words are cheap. I can easily say this guy has done it wrong, but if they ask me how should it be done to do it right, I may not have a solution template. You get the point now? Then I've said nothing because everybody knows he's doing it wrong. But himself that brought himself out to say I will take up the role, even though he doesn't have the solution, you don't have the solution, you cannot compare yourself to him, because at least he brings himself out to see somebody in that place. Now look at the bottom level. The elderly people, they're glued to up the normal come up, fine. But how long do they have to live, though? You get? Today now, Dubai is celebrating, UAE is celebrating 50 years. You get? They are celebrating 50 years. And look at the growth within 50 years. So if we have you said?
I said to save our time, I think I need to bring out something from what you said.
Okay.
You see, one thing I picked first from your analysis, you talked about the elderly and corruption. You know, if we say the elders are corrupt, and it will be difficult to wipe people that corrupt, you know, culture, you know, from them, what should we say about the young people that we have today?
Yeah, This is the point. But the young, I know the young are corrupt, but we can train them, isn't it? We have the opportunity of building a better foundation.
Going forward, in understanding our problem, like you mentioned, the problem does not, actually stop at the bottom. And also it does not stop at the top. Now, the question is, I will cite an example. And that example, I don't know if you recall, there is this guy on social media, this Omo Ishan or something from Edo State. Mm-hmm. I brought out a particular issue of one project that was awarded by the federal government through the Federal House of Rep member in that constituency. And the project was done in a shady way.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I know that guy. That the road and drainage.
Of where they were actually doing the drainage. Mm-hmm. He was, just using his hand alone. Uprooting some of those things that they put, mm-hmm. that they think have done a very good project in a where erosion is critically disturbing them. Now, if we go by analysis, the project is a federal government project that emanated to the federal budget, signed by the president after being looked at after by the National Assembly. Now, the procedure of budgeting or implementation in the country, we all know that once the federal government budget, it goes down to the ministry. Through the ministry or whether the agencies, this project get to see implementation, whether through a contractor or through somebody. Now, if we say the man at the top, for example, now let's say, okay, the president who signed or assented to that budget or that bill for it to become a law to be implemented for a whole financial year. Do we blame him for signing such project to be implemented to the people and releasing fund? Or should we blame the ministry? When I say the ministry, it is not the minister in question. It is the civil servants who that are paid salaries.
Yeah.
We blame them for that kind of job that has been done. Also, should we blame the people, who are being given the job to do and they are doing it for their own people? You get the point I'm making. So from top now, if you realize it's coming down to bottom. So the point now is, who should we blame? It's just like a father that gave money in the house to go and buy foodstuff. And eventually they used that money, they bought toys and they bought so many things they didn't buy food. Should we blame the father who gave the money? Or we blame the mother who say, oh, father, please give them money, let them go and buy this thing. So the point is, sometimes even we as a people, we don't know what we want. You understand the point? We don't know what we want. Then when it comes to development, like I always listened to one interview. I think it was an interview or it was a political campaign by our late Chief Wabiola. He said, you don't shave people's head behind them. You understand the point I'm making? And that said, further, I said, the best doctor in Norway, when you bring that doctor to Nigeria, might not be the best doctor because they have never seen malaria in Norway before. And the person, if you bring him to Africa for him to treat malaria, it means that person, would rather fail than, doing what is needful. Now, the same way when it comes to development, when it comes to bringing, policy papers and, putting them forward for implementation, I think we also need to look into, that critically, that the way and manner of how we do things, of how we achieve, success cannot be similar or cannot be uniform. You get the point I'm making? Let me give you an instance. Go and look at the history of how, actually got to where they are at. Look of the history of how China got to where they are today. You see, there are two different things. And if you recall, under Babangida era in 1985 or 1986, there was what we call this structural adjustment program. It's just like, preferring uniform solution to different problems. You get the point I'm making? So in the context of our problem, as a people, I think we need to go back from community, from states, from region, from wherever we come from, look inwards into what exactly suits, you know, our demand. Then let us now provoke what we call development from that, you know, basis. It is not by saying, oh, because a particular policy worked for somebody in Delta State, and definitely if you take the same policy to Damaturu, the same policy will work. Yesterday we were here talking about, was it yesterday or the day before?
2 days ago,
talking about, you know, bring about a particular policy of, you know, putting Friday work free day. And we all argued. We said, that thing that man is doing there, if care is not taken, will create problem all over the country. So the same thing applies to the fact that when you are implementing a policy, you have to be very careful, you know, in understanding what exactly is the need of your people. So in the same way, if we want development, we need to understand the culture, the belief, the understanding of the people, you know, as to, okay, how do we think we can actually come out of this quagmire of underdevelopment? So it is not by saying, oh, because if we have problem, the problem of leadership, what about the problem of followership? Okay, I'll give you an instance. Do you know, up to today, there are still so many communities in some part of Africa where if their governments take projects to them, they will call the contractor and say, oh, we don't want this project, just bring the money, let's share this money.
What you said, nice, true, because I've seen someone actually advertising government project on Facebook, literally. So local government projects, state projects, and they will advertise and tell you the agent will get this amount, the contractor will be paid this amount, then you that's buying the project, you will be getting the balance. So I was asking myself, this is the money that has come from federal level up to state. So you can imagine how many people that have taken their share from top before you got to this level, and this person still want to sell it on Facebook for a contractor that they don't even know.
So the point is, if we actually wanted development, I think we need to look inward. You know, if you go to some community, like I live very well in Cross River State. And I think where I lived, somewhere around Ikom Ajaso area, I think my little period of staying there, I come to realize that they have their own cultures and tradition. In that community, a young person should dare not, you know, go into anything that has to do with gambling. In that community, a young lady who peradventure by mistake got pregnant cannot abort that pregnancy. That is their culture, it is their tradition. And they have a way of dealing with their issues when they have it. So in such community, if you want to approach development, I'll give you another example. In that same community, if you have anything that has to do with a breakdown of law and order, if the police, the DSS, or any security agents will arrest anybody, they have to see the chief. You understand? It is when the chief now can sit down, look critically into the matter, and realize that, oh, this person has done wrong, and this person is liable to be punished, you know, by virtue of the law. In this context, now the law is not their own condition. Then they will ask the police to say, okay, good, take them away. But in the context of if it is something that they feel they can still resolve within themselves, as much as possible to resolve this thing. You understand? Apportion blame to the person who is at fault, give him the right punishments, you understand, and tell him to apologize. Then tell the person, you know, who is the victim of that circumstance, okay, I'm very sorry of this circumstance, this person will do this person will do that. I remember the friend of mine fell a victim of a particular issue, you know, where person, you know, youth in that community, you know, laid an ambush and wanted to attack him. Eventually, the matter got to the game and the police. Well, their first point of call was to go to the chief. When the matter got to the chief, you know, was the biological son of that chief that was even the main culprit of the particular, you know, case I'm talking about. And eventually, when the man came up with his own policy and said, okay, hey, this guy, I know you are my biological son, but this does not, you know, mean that I shouldn't say the truth before this people. You are at fault. And this is your punishment. The youth of the community should go and deal with him, which they did. So in that circumstance, if you have forcefully a particular law that is in a community, for them, do you think will happen? Do you think they will develop?
No, not really, yeah.
The answer is no. What we need to do as a people is for us to, you see, everybody has a where we come from. Whether you are a federal civil servant, whether you are a state civil servant, whether you are a politician, a councilor, you are a chairman of a local government, you are a senator, you are this, you are that, every bit of where we come from. So let us all go back to where we come from, understand what our people actually need or needed. It's not all about, you know, giving water when they don't need water, when they need. But because this is what you want to do as their leader or as the person representing them, you now give them. It is not all about, you know, sharing money because you feel your people are dying of poverty. It's all about what do you do to bring them out of that poverty. If you give them money, they will spend the money. So the point is understanding our plight, proposing or projecting a ways of actually tackling, you know, this, you know, problems can only be the solution, instead of somebody sit down somewhere and begin to write a white paper that does not exist. I don't know if it happens in any community. Like, okay, in this period, president, the budget before the National Assembly. Before the president made the budget, did you notice that so maybe anybody the community and ask them, okay, what do you want? Was there any time ask the people, okay,
exactly the point.
What is the main problem or the main thing that you want the government to do for you in the next 1 year to ameliorate your sufferings? Did you see anything that, you know, like that coming up? Or did you even come across any committee? Of course, our representative will say, oh, they are the ones representing us because we have given them the responsibility. Do they even come back home? Don't ask us what we want. At least we have seen whereby House of Rep members were being beaten by their constituents because they refused to come back home after they have won election. And yet that person will continue to represent them, propose that, okay, my community, this is what they lack. But people do not even have a constituency office in their own community where they come from. And that person is representing them, believing that he wants to provide a solution to their problem. Some local government chairmen do not even know the number of persons in local government. All they know is I'm the local government. When allocation comes, I decide whatever I want to do for my people. And the way they do it, they won't do it as if I haven't been a favor for taxpayers' money.
This is just where our problem is. And that's why I keep saying that it is all about engagement. The engagement between the leaders and the masses is not there. Because a good example, look at the NSAS report that they brought out in Lagos State recently, and look at the reaction of the state government to the report. When they said they were looking at it, I was thinking personally, I was thinking, okay, if it took them this 1 year to look at it, to put up that report, meaning it will take the government a couple of months again to implement, to strategize how do we approach this. And thinking that will happen, the governor just came and said he's organizing a peace walk. Okay, question is, how will he actually create peace or unify the people when you've not actually bring justice to the whatever the allegation was or is? And that, why do you not see why people think, yeah, look at the reaction of social media? The reaction is really out of so you can see the reaction is out of order. Why? It's because there was no consultation from the leaders. I was thinking, okay, now that has happened, that the best thing the governor would have done, which is what I expected from Babaji Sowolu, is engage Lagos State residents in media chat for at least 1 month. Even if it's just 2 days a week or 1 day a week, engage in media chat. Let them come, let people ask questions. Put questions there. What do we do now? We've got the report. This is what we've had. What do you think? Well, how can you hear from the people? Get the solution template from them. Don't bring your solution. You have your own, but keep yours aside. Then get the solution from, okay, we apologize. We want to really hear from everybody. We heard from those who actually investigated the situation in your own eyes. or in your own idea, what do you think we can do to bring Lagos to the Lagos we used to have, a unified Lagos, where we're not be saying hoodlums or how do we put those boys together? That is what I was expecting. That way, you will see that the whatever that will be implemented will be that it will be in line with what the masses are looking for, because the projection will be from them. Okay, we want this, or if we do this, it will actually go a long way in actually resolving the conflict. We left all those ones, all we could actually put up is just to jump up and say, oh, peace walk. Okay, after the peace walk, what next? So you expect we should just forget about the case after the peace walk? You see the problem we have.
TG, I think I have a different opinion about the issue of the, you know, NSAS panel reports.
Oh, okay.
I think on October 20th, 2020, I was one of those people who actually criticized the government for taking a wrong approach when the issue of the toll gate specifically happened. But then that does not stop us from saying the right thing and speaking the truth.
Okay.
That the time for truth comes.
Yeah.
You see, like I said, and I've continued to say, you know, on this show, is today in Nigeria, we tend to, you know, believe, you know, too much on media sensationalism.
Definitely, yeah.
Understanding the right thing and the right information taken. I will not comment much, but then even looking at that report, you know, you question the integrity of such reports.
I understand.
Out of their findings.
It is possible.
Out of their findings, they discovered that 11 people died. Out of 11 people, they only compensated one. And reports, you know, came up few days after the leaked reports. Okay, there were even some persons whose name appeared on that 11, you know, persons who the whom the panel claimed died, who has even surfaced on social media platforms after the 20th of October. You call, you know, for that kind of reports an integrity free. I'm not saying the government does not have their own blame in, you know, the circumstance. What that is critically looking at, okay, if we say, okay, on the social media, people are actually kicking against what the governor has said, what the governor has this, you know, you understand? But the point is, during the panel of inquiry, where all these things, you know, proving, you know, to be, even from what we gathered that even foreign experts that came and appeared before the panel, the forensic experts, the opinion of that forensic expert was not even adopted. You understand the point? Because autopsy were actually carried out on, I think, about three corpses that were taken to the morgue on the 21st. You understand? I don't want to comment much on this report. Let it not be as if maybe I'm on the side of it. You understand?
Yeah.
But the point is, the integrity of that panel report. You see, what I just see is just an orchestrated, you know, attempt, you know, to discredit the people of Lagos. Okay, look, if we say, okay, 11 people died, can you count the number of policemen who lost their life? Then who is to take responsibility of the policemen who lost their life during the process? And if you, even before the Lekki issue came up, the police were even overwhelmed.
Yeah, I understand. Yeah. But
why the government, the military, in a situation where the police, you know, were overwhelmed, there is breakdown of law and order in the state. What do you expect? What next?
Yeah, I understand.
So, you see, the point is, our overnight activists who believe they know it all, understand? There are certain things they have failed to realize when it comes to governing or governance.
Yeah, no. That's what I said earlier. If you watch my introduction, I said the same.
You see, the governor did that. Despite the fact that there are some positions he took, even immediately and after the issue of that Lekki that I didn't support. You understand? The position he took as a leader, I think, is the best that he can take for now. Because if you continue to drag it from right and left, then who will succumb to the...
okay.
Listen, some group of people who actually, you know, said and believe that, okay, people... that, okay, we heard of DJ Switch, who said 87. After 87, she said 70. After 70, she said 15. Now the panel said 11.
My point is not on, it's not on justifying whether the panel is correct or wrong. If the panel is correct, then the government did well. If the panel is still wrong, let me tell you something, which this one, what we must learn in Africa is, we must learn to take responsibility for our actions. The panel was set up, hold on. The panel was set up by the government, yeah? The panel was set up by the government, and the government knows who I should be competent for such position. So if you use the wrong person to carry out a task, the blame comes back to the same government. Let's put that aside. So mine is not even on the competence of the report. Mine is the conflict resolution strategy. Sometimes you learn to hear from the crying children, even though you know already, but sometimes you see what there's the point. I'm not talking about whether the report is correct or wrong. No, what I'm talking about is after when you look at the heat in the system, sometimes just pretend like you have a listening ear. Come out and say, I want to hear your view now. We've listened to this one already, but let's hear your view so we can collate. This is the point now. That way the people will get, okay, let's assume you called Mr. Macaroni and say, Mr. Macaroni, we've had this report, you were in that scene. We want to hear your view as a person. Now, this is not the panel calling you. It is me as a governor and my panel. We want to hear your view to see what you had. And we want to hear your opinion. This is the point now. So, when you start doing that in the media chat, let the people call in and their own fans call in, I believe we may arrive at a solution that the people will be happy with quicker. And the people will not, the solution may not necessarily mean prosecuting all the leaders. Sometimes we just say, the leadership person, I always say something is, those foreign activists today may not necessarily give us good leadership if you put them there. A good activist is just a good protester. They are good at managing protest. They may not be good at managing society.
Quite agree with you in totality. But the question is this. I think I followed, the ENSA's protest, aftermath of the answers of until this point. And if you recall, even the so-called overnight activists that I call them, you understand, they even alleged that during the protests, if you recall, during the protest, the governor himself went to the protest ground, spoke to them. After he left the demand, the governor went straight down to Abuja. You understand, presented it before students. And yet, after when the governor came back to the state, he requested that the leaders of those people who were leading this protest should be invited to the state house.
Yeah.
He's the governor that he's inviting them, he wants to. And you see, that is why, that is my problem with the young people.
Exactly, yeah. That, on that ground, yes.
See, when you are fighting, sometimes because you are not fighting a war, there is need for that. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
The dialogue which they failed to recognize at that time is the problem that they are fighting today.
Mm.
See, I'll tell you the truth. You see, I said it here when I was making my analysis. See, sometimes when you see certain things happening in the country, I mentioned the fact that there have been sponsored political movements, there have been sponsored protests, there have been sponsored this. In a way and manner, even what came out after the answers, when they were alleging themselves of corruption, I don't know if you remember, when the so-called activists were alleging themselves of corruption, shows that, even the protest, in a way we can conclude that the protest was a sponsored one.
Yeah, to an extent, you can say the protest, because if there was no sponsorship, you wouldn't see food and other kind of setting that we're seeing at the end.
You see, for my own personal opinion, I don't want to go too much details into that, because I'm not happy, both with the government and on the side of the young people. You get the point I'm making? We are talking about different wars, different things happening. Okay, look at China, America and China, when they had issues. At one point, what did they do? They came to round table. Okay, look at this, the issue of Brexit, that UK is battling with other European countries, especially France. What have they been doing? If you recall, about a few weeks ago, the fishing line of
France,
of whether UK or French border.
French, yeah, but yeah.
What did Boris Johnson? He went there and he sent somebody, sent delegation there, and they've been having dialogue. So if at that time they presented a 5 demand, you see, presenting a and you know, at that time, if you recall, most of the demand, you know, ended up in, you know, calling for the men to be accountable for everything, not even against police brutality alone. And I said it at that time, you know, they were saying, oh, enters. I never agreed with the point, you know, of enters. I only agreed with the point of it should be end police brutality instead of enters. Okay, mm-hmm. After the end enters, now look at the security situation that we have found ourselves.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. You should respect that. And that's what I keep saying, that sometimes...
Whether the operative officers are doing bad, whether they are doing good, the fact remains that in the lead they are doing good, they are protecting the lives of our people. But in the way they are doing bad, that is what we should look into. But end police brutality suddenly became an attack against somebody, suddenly became attack against this. You know, before you know anything, you begin to question the integrity of such.
Yeah, I understand. And I've said that before now, that...
I know of young people during the protest are sharing money for people.
Yeah, I understand that, definitely. But this is why I keep saying that. Are they young?
I don't want to begin to go into that. You see, I love the protest. Because that was the first time Nigerian young people, you know, came up and said, oh, enough is enough of these social and political problems that we've had in the country. But along the line, we got, you know, so many things wrong, giving the government an edge over our demand. You get the point I'm making?
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't want to dwell much because sometimes when I listen to some of these overnight activists, I'm sorry if I'm using these statements. I'm not being insulting or being abusive about anybody or anybody. Mm-hmm. And that's why I've restricted my name of, you know, for not mentioning names. You see, there are certain things. The English man who fights and goes back, come back another day, is the warrior. You understand the point?
Mm-hmm.
Don't fight and, you know, finish a battle at once. All what we wanted at that time as young people is to fight and finish that battle at Gito Gator in Abuja.
If
you want good roads, if you say you want good roads, you want electricity, you want... I see at that level of that protest that will come. At that time, the government said, okay, they said, okay, they are suspended us. Okay, the 5/5 demand. They are going to, you know, set up a committee to look forward, to look up to it. They are going to increase, what else do you expect the government to do at that time?
Yeah, but so, it's the same thing I'm saying, that sometimes with the youth, they don't have solution template.
It makes us believe that, you know, some of these people, some of these notable faces that we see championing the cause of that protest, even looking at their antecedents, you know that, you know, some of these things are sponsored. Of course, they write in their own opinion to say, okay, this is what we want. This is what we demand for. But then at some point, we all got it wrong. Let us accept that fact. And even the governor calling for, you see what the governor has called for when he said, let's work for peace. It's only a dialogue. You can still engage the governor. The governor said, okay, I'm inviting you to work for a peace. The next, all of them begin to, they came onto the social media.
I understand.
Institutionalism, it will not bring about solution.
Yeah, but I understand the point. What you're saying, I understand. I've said something that you...
That will not bring... You know, tell you, a problem without dialogue cannot see solution.
Definitely. That is the point I'm saying. That's why I say our leaders, most of the time, we need to hear the people bottom level too. When you give room for that chat every time, conversation with them...
G, let me put this to you. I recall... You know, a few days after the Lekki Toll Gate incident, somebody was interviewed. When the person came on here, he said, when the soldiers started shooting, I carried the dead, I carried that some people had died, the cops. I put it there. Who can do that to a village in Nigeria? Okay, today, I even watched an interview on Arise TV where a particular young boy was invited with one of the NSAS protest leaders. And the question that was raised was, okay, if you say people died at the Lekki Toll Gate, were there facts and figures presented before the panel, you know, to ascertain the fact that actually died? Okay, I'm sorry to use this statement, our minister said, he said, even if a goat, you know, is missing, you now have the goat to look for that goat. So these 11 people do not have families.
No. Let's look at one thing. See, you see, Nigeria case, I always say, is a complicated case. And that's why I say, the only way we can arrive at a good country, in my opinion, is we must engage, as in we must dialogue and we must educate both the bottom level. In fact, the bottom level will change the system. That's my belief. The solution to a good economy in Africa at large is at the bottom, not at the top. Yes, this is my belief. And that is a belief that has not been tested yet. You get the point? Now, let me tell you something. Let me bring out a point here.
Let me just give you this one.
Okay.
Last year, I was privileged to be part of an idea, where the governor of Lagos in this contest now wanted to have, I think 1,300 and something projects for each ward to be implemented. Now, fortunately, I have a friend who is part of the committee, and he approached me. He said, "Oh, community, where you come from? I'm interested in that community because you have done so much for us. Can you please schedule a meeting for us to come and speak with the people of that community to demand for what we actually wanted?" You understand the point?
Yeah.
Went into the community. I called, stakeholders of the community. I told them the agenda of the government. This is what the government wanted. They are coming. The delegation was led by the SSG. Not just a civil servant, the SSG. We had people from UNDP who had to do monitoring and evaluation. We have people from WHO. We have people from so many international organizations who were ready to work with the state government in implementing those projects award. Now, you know the funny scenario? When we got to the meeting, one young man came out and said they needed a community hall. This is a community that has been battling with the issue of water supply. This is a community that has been battling with the issue of erosion when it rains. This is a community that has been battling with youth unrest as a result of youth unemployment. This is a community that has been battling with bad roads. This is a community that only has just a primary school, no single secondary school. The people of the community will have to go to a secondary school. They have to travel for at least 3 miles. You understand the point? And somebody came up and said, "Oh, we needed a community hall." What do you think we should call that? So sometimes, even when the government throw it at us that, okay, what do we want? Like I said, even we the people do not even know, not even understand what.
I understand. Not the way we say we the people. It's not everyone, isn't it? One majority of people are still sound-minded.
In bringing dialogue, sometimes, if the government, all teams, still go back to the government. If the government does not, in the standard of basic knowledge, I will not call it basic education now, basic knowledge, that is, reorienting the people as to what their civic rights and responsibilities are. You understand the point now? Reorientating the people, you see, probably that is what I feel we needed. If you continue to, make this noise here, do this one day, it will not bring solution. Let's go back to the issue of Lagos. If the committee or the panel of inquiry, as they have presented their reports, the governor has compared that the fact that, the governor is accepting that, so thing happened, this one happened, that one happened, then what is the solution? At least we know that even during the sitting of the panel, so many people have been compensated with millions of naira. So now the point we should not ask ourselves is, then if the government takes responsibility and after being compensated, giving compensation to the victims of our police brutality, the lives during the process, then what else do you think will be the next thing? Is to galvanize the state, and in galvanizing the state, call for peace. Let me tell you, I watched when the governor was making his press online about the white paper reports. The first thing I told my friend when I was chatting, I said the governor did not take a right approach. You know why?
Why?
The reason why I said the governor did not take a right approach is, of course, your position about the white paper. What you should do first what you should do first is to again reiterate the call for dialogue.
Exactly.
If they not, I know they will not attend.
No, even if they don't, if it indicates you like, oh, that makes you feel.
The social media will not recognize that. In the same way they are ranting, it's the same way they are going to rant.
But it doesn't matter. See,
let me tell you, I know the lawyer representing the answers because I know him personally. I know him personally. I know what he can do. You understand? These are people who do not recognize dialogue in their dictionary. You understand? They will never recognize that. All they wanted is they wanted to just be seen fighting every government that comes. And you cannot fight everybody and win.
But this is where our youth keep getting it wrong. If you look at what the mainstream media has caused, yeah.
You see, the point is the deed has been done. You understand? There is nothing that will come from the mouthpiece of the Lagos State government tomorrow that the so-called overnight, you know, young people will accept. I tell you the truth.
But this is where we are stuck.
See, I know where some of these things are coming from. You understand? And that was why I mentioned the fact that let us, you know, be truthful. Let us be objective.
Yes.
Only but with country. You see, fighting somebody because somebody is telling you to fight that person will not help us.
Perfect.
Because you want to speak the truth. Will not help us, rather than you speaking truth to what you want to even speak.
But this is what I've said. The mainstream media has actually brought us to, I don't know why everything we have in Africa is always, they will bring good thing, but the good thing, we will use it in the wrong way. Our mainstream media always try to carve out things that will make everyone jump, whether it is right or wrong.
The mainstream media in Nigeria has failed us as a nation. I will say it anyway.
Come again?
The mainstream media has failed us as a nation.
Exactly. I was thinking you were saying that it has helped us. I was like, no.
If our mainstream media can make a publication as a result of hearsay and come back to apologize, what integrity do you think that mainstream media would have before the people that understand what has actually happened? I don't know if you recall, about a few days ago, the Minister for Works, you know, played the 2 million, 2 billion naira libel suit against some of our top media houses. You understand? So the point is, media, you know, in the current dispensation, have become too sensational. Maybe because they don't like the man in Aso Rock.
But that's why I keep saying that. We're not there to like each other. We're there to work for a common purpose of developing the nation. So if that's our aim, all this activism and all this, it's like now.
It's in this country where you and I, where we are reporting from. You think we don't have people that hate Boris Johnson?
Of course.
You think we don't have media that hate Boris Johnson? Mm-hmm. Or would you ever see them bringing up a fake news against Boris Johnson because they hate him?
This is where our problem is. I keep saying this is where our problem is.
People like somebody as a result of his policy, attack those policies and make them be constructive. You don't attack the person without having a genuine purpose, a genuine reason. You understand the point?
Yeah.
I don't want us to dwell too much on that because I'm so, you know, I'm so furious when it comes to the issue of that answers because despite the fact that we, the young people, actually got so many things right, we failed in some circumstances. And that failure is what the government is actually capitalizing against upon. You understand the point? As young people, we need to stand firm. Look at that. Look at the way they molested themselves. After a few periods, they said, yes, this is that the likes of the Jaden Yonju have been attacking for so many months before the NSAS protests. The same EFCC is the same, you know, body they are calling to come and investigate the NSAS financial management. You know, young people, who wants to take over from the so-called the age people, the old people that we have been talking about. You know, at some point they came up with the idea of they paid pro bono lawyers. Pro bono lawyers, so many people are still laying flour in prisons all over the country, arrested during the NSAS protests. Then what did the pro bono lawyers do? And some people are calling for the integrity of the same government. My brother, anybody that wants equity must come with clean hand. Let's go to another discussion.
Thank you very much. Let me leave you to go on this note, because when we look at the issue of Nigeria, honestly, this topic is not finished, because I believe there's a lot we can do, but we people are chasing shadows. Currently, people are still chasing shadows. Why this topic? Let me explain to you now. Look at this. Look at the situation we have. That we will sit down during election, we'll campaign for somebody, or someone like Shuri, whatever it is. You campaign heavily for Buhari, only for Buhari to come, you're not fighting Buhari. You get? No, they cannot the same thing. Compared for Jonathan, only for Jonathan to have come in. So if we want to always stay on the antagonistic side, or want to always be leading the campaign, then we will not give room for the government. We will be focused, and the energy we're using to chase all these, yeah, whether good or bad, there should be a strategic way of going about. I always use this Scottish referendum thing to give example. The Scottish people want to go to have an independence. They've been chasing it for years, but not one soul has been lost.
Somebody wanted to see that of Nigeria. He was attacking people around the southwest. Is that how to go by it?
Uh-huh. So you see the point. And at the end of the day, some of these things will bring up, like, okay, when they brought ESN, I was debating with a friend. I told my friend that this is when they've not launched, the rumor was that they are training people in the booth, blah, blah, blah. I told somebody, I said, if actually they're training people, this guy won't kill people away. He said, how? I said, let me tell you. I said, the people you're gathering, why, you don't know their integrity, you don't know who is who, you could be courtists, you could be robbers, you're mixing all of them up. Now, tomorrow, even if these boys work for you today, get me wrong, these boys will work for you today, but tomorrow, if you not get money, satisfy their urge, they'll pick up those aim and attack the same community. And that another thing is, the government will use this...
What is happening to the issue of kidnapped X-Men? Naturally started from the south during the time of the oil bunkering and the likes. Look at how it has spread to the whole of the country.
Exactly. So this thing, we don't really think this through. Okay, you want to even implement something that you don't want to consult your local leaders. And look at the people I'm talking about here now, because I want to be very direct. When Shewore came, Shewore was okay. I want to change Nigeria, but you are abusing everybody. That's my own. You have good template of idea. You want to implement an idea, but we should understand one thing: to bring about a change, you cannot just kill everybody in the system and say you want to build a new system. It is impossible. So when you say they are all bad, you keep abusing all of them. You are meant. Personally, I believe you are meant to be strategic and logical. Lobby all of them, find a simple way to relate with them, and find a way to put yourself in the system so you can start implementing your ideas. Rather than you fighting them, the other end is the same. You come when you are abusing your own leaders, your fathers, your parents, stuff like that. Let's leave the conversation here so that we can meet again tomorrow or any other day that you'll be free. And if you're just watching us joining us at this point, please do well to subscribe and join us here every day, 6 p.m. UK time, not 7 p.m. Nigeria time during the winter. And let's do this again. Thank you very much, Mr. Tinubu, for coming on today. And I hope to see you again on this show.
Thank you.
Okay, there. Thank you very much. Ooh.